If all of the kings had their queens on the throne, we would pop champagne and raise a toast.
So to
all of the queens who are fighting alone, baby, hey, you're not dancing. Yeah.
Lucky to get close to the throne. I'm not worthy, but she's taking me home. Yeah. No damsel in distress, no need to save her. She's a goddess, I would never try to change her. She knows she got my world inside of her palm, but she can have whatever she wants.
Let's go. I'm a queen, I'm a boss, I'm a brat. Yeah. Hella independent, I get this, I get that. Uh-huh. Shout out to the girls from the burp to the trap. I don't need a man for shit, put myself on the map.
Oh,
and they thought I was done. I ain't even hit my peak and I'm still on the run. I'm my Lolo on the laptop, running the track. Only time I see an L's in a luxury tax. And my whole team when they post a pic just because they're like, oh, she chillin'.
Yeah.
Me and all the girls and my lipstick still it. I need acrylic nails, I don't need no critics. So where they gon' glow, so where they gon' shine.
Yeah.
Circle full of tens, I don't see no nines. My name on they lips, my name on they mind. How I take it from the block to the Hollywood sky.
You stole my heart, you intercepted it. Now you're gone, have to accept it. Did I meet your mom too soon? Or did I do what I always do? Yeah, we made it to the 50, and then you kissed me. We made it to the 40, a new love story. We made it to the 30, and you did me dirty right then. You put the ending tight end. And as I touched down, just like you in a game, I'm in another town, and nothing feels the same. Wish I could go back when we met that day. Oh, whoa, and throw a flag on the play.
But it was all in your head.
Why are we talking Taylor Swift? I just realized I did not plug my mic in. Hold on 1 second. Why are we talking Taylor Swift? This is not a Taylor Swift stream. One intro that I put in there. And I'm getting persecuted for one intro. And that's an AI song. But yeah, it's one video. So it's one video. But no. We're past that intro. Hello, Jeremy Burns. Welcome to today's stream. I'm not gonna read that because I might get my channel struck. But I see Jabba's causing havoc in the chat. He's trying to get me canceled. So I will keep an eye on you, Jabba. I'll keep an eye on you. To address this comment, this is not a Taylor Swift stream. We're not doing Taylor Swift. But yes, I guarantee most of you wouldn't kick her out of your bed. I know I wouldn't. Let's see. A female song usually has to do with the music isn't any good. Her earlier stuff was good. I like Taylor Swift's earlier stuff when she wasn't trying to be a slut. I like it was nice and catchy stuff. I also have some nostalgia to it as well. Not so much with Katy Perry. She was always like I don't think she had the talent that Taylor Swift is. Why are we talking about this? This is not that stream. We're not doing that stream here. Bear says, yeah, that would be a step up for what? A step up from what? What's wrong with you? What's wrong with you people coming in here? Sci-fi is life with the harassment. My good friend Suzanne Eckstein. Hello, Suzanne. It's wonderful seeing you here. Thank you for your support. Thank you for showing up here. So, just quickly, I want to show you guys something. And this has been encouraging for me in the direction that I'm going and showing these artist spotlight streams. In the last month, I've gained 29 subscribers. So my subscriber count is climbing. So to those of you that subscribe to my channel, hail. And to the one or two of you assholes that are going to unsubscribe because of this, go fuck yourself. I don't know. But I am definitely encouraged by this news. So thank you for supporting me. Thank you for being here. And thank you for what I'm hoping will be entertainment. Because one thing you cannot say about these streams that I've done is they haven't been boring. Even when I say they're going to be boring, they're not boring. They just don't ever become boring. Because for some reason, like your hate and harassment just brings entertainment value to this. It's 8:02 already. Shut your mouth, Jabba. Shut your fucking mouth. I'm so tired of you. But don't think I don't know. Oh, wait. So I talked about this on my stream last night, but with regards to these artist spotlight streams, I want to keep everything canon within the stream. So I'm going to show you again. If you didn't see it last night, that's fine. It's only canon if I show it on these streams. So last night, I got my copy of let me see if I can do it on camera. Here we go. I got my copy of Von Bode's Cheech Wizard Volume 1. I showed it yesterday, but I'm going to show it again here because this is where it matters. These are the streams that this stuff matters. Volume 1, it wasn't as thick as I had hoped, but as I explained in the last stream with Von Bode, his stuff, for some reason, is very expensive because they're out of print. So you're not going to find like a newly imprint volume of his works for anywhere from like a $20 range. At best, you'll probably end up paying anywhere from 50 close to 200 for reprint of his stuff. So I got this for 23, was it? I think it was like 23 bucks, or it's 18. It was 18. And you know, I had hoped it'd be thicker, but it still got some good stuff. It's got his first prints of the not his first prints, the first printed copies of his early, you know, the beginning stories of Cheech Wizard. Right, and I talked about how Bode did what I liked with the text, where he made the text part of the image, part of the artwork. So it's not like you're looking at two separate entities; you're looking at one image, one I said the word, but one entity. So I like this a lot. I'm gonna read this. It was very 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 wonderful use of black and white. This is not a newsprint. And I was a little creepy yesterday smelling the newsprint, but there's nothing like the scent of newsprint. I think. I just like the scent of newsprint. It's very, very nostalgic. So Yeah, so I wish I had showed this on the stream last week, but I didn't get it last week. But I'm here now, so I'm showing it now. So this is a, you know what I should do, right? I should probably put the overhead light on, because I wasn't going to go on camera, but since I'm going to be on camera for this, I think I should show with a better light. And let me not boomer. But here's the, here you go. See, it looks much better now. So yeah, this is the earlier stories, Chief Wizard stories. And I really like how this looks. You can see how the art and the text just become one entity. I like this a lot. This is funny because today's artist spotlight was the one artist that actually implanted in me the whole image, the art text to be one entity. So this kind of is a nice segue to it. But yeah, I mean, I'm gonna do a review of this at some point. I'm gonna read it and review it and talk about it, and you know, we'll go more to the whole image text what's the word for it? I don't know. I'm at a loss for word. Sometimes when I go on stream, I forget the words I want to use. I don't know why, but I have to make up words. I guess writers do that. We just make up words. Geek Avenger says, how does Java know your dog is gay? I'm afraid to ask that question or answer because it involves me going into the deepest, darkest pit of humanity. I will not do that. It's too late for Java. That's not too late for me. And it shouldn't be for you. Alignment, is your room pink? No, it's not pink. It's just the lighting. Wait. It's not pink. No, it's not pink. It's just, okay, no, it's the... It's not pink. It's different. At some point, it's getting repainted. It's not pink. It's I think it's orange, like an orange color, kind of. But this light doesn't do it justice. Compop says I like it. Refer to the comic, the Cheech Wizard comic. Yes, I like it too. Like I said, I'm gonna do a review of it. We have a Dillard sighting. Dillard draws. He says artist spotlight. Yes, yes, artist spotlight each weekend. I mean, each week. So, let's see. So then the next thing continues. Oh no, I see the color not. The light made it look pink. Yeah, because the other light was, I had the lamp light on, but I wasn't planning on turning my camera on. And I realized that when I turn the camera on and I'm showing the Cheech Wizard book, it doesn't show it clearly. So I had to put the overhead light on and that changes the light. You didn't catch shit, Java. You didn't catch shit. Caught nothing. Bear says, do your dogs have a suspicious lisp? No, add it? What's with your broken sentences? What is with your broken sentences? Chat giving Dillard hail, well wishes. Oh no, my abuser shifter's here. He says, I had to use filters because he's a lizard person. Well, that is true. I am a lizard person. I do like the lizards because I'm just a fan of lizards. I like lizards. There's no lie in that statement. I do like lizards. And it's funny because the thumbnail for the stream has a dinosaur. Dinosaurs are lizards. And there's no greater lizard than Godzilla himself. Yeah, look, I'm shilling my tchotchke. See? There you go. See, I am a lizard person. Absolutely. If it isn't Godzilla that I'm shilling, it'll be another lizard. Like my friend Angulus. There you go. See? He's a lizard too. Yes, I am a Godzilla fan, so I just shilled my Godzilla stuff, so no shame. Dillard says, what's up, Geek Avenger? Java continues harassment. They were doing it over the peanut butter jar. No, they weren't. I don't even have a jar. 10 likes, 7 watches, says JD Kirby. Yes, on the YouTube side, we have 12 people watching, which means that we have 16 on the Twitter side, because I have 27 total people watching. So let's bring up the views, bring up the likes, bring up the engagement. If you're watching on Twitter, feel free to comment. Hit the reply button, and you will be featured in the stream. You will become part of the show and part of the content. And if this is your first time watching, hit that like and subscribe button. There you go. This is how you do it, in case you don't know how. So hit the like, subscribe, bell notification, and that's how you keep my channel going, because my channel is currently shadow banned by the YouTube gods. Or goddesses, I should say. But you can help me overcome that shadow ban, that evil, racist shadow ban, by hitting that like, subscribe, and the bell icon. So when I go live, you come on and engage with us so that you can become part of the show, part of content, and more importantly, part of history. Yes, we're making history. That's what I've heard, Shifter. Lizards are tasty. One day I will eat an alligator and I'll come back and I'll give you a progress report. But I hear it tastes like chicken, so. No, Suzanne, I don't let Jabba set me off. I do not let him set me off. He has no power over me. None. I don't let him. Giga Avenger says, oh no, although he, there goes Tokyo, Godzilla. Don't hail J.D. Kirby, Suzanne. He's anathema. He's become one of the biggest harassers in the circle. Don't hail him. I refuse him. I don't care if he's being nice now. I don't care if he's being nice, J.D. Kirby. I don't care. I don't hail you. You're a harasser. Geek Avenger says, stop talking. Why are you guys? Okay, you guys went from talking about Taylor Swift to talking about my dogs. What? Just stop it. Stop doing that. It's weird. No, they're not little gay dogs. Stop it. They're my therapy dogs. They're my happiness. You don't get to come on my show. I don't permit you, Jabba, to insult and curse upon my dogs. I don't allow it. And yes, gator meat, from what I heard, is great. One day I will try it. And yes, one day I will give you a progress report. No, Jabba's homeless. He's homeless, Bear. He's homeless. He's absolutely freaking literally homeless. I don't allow him to derail my plans. And more importantly, to derail the beauty of me. Because I'm important. I'm very important. I'm a POC, so you can't derail my importance. Absolutely not. Oh, wait, what is this? What am I looking at there? Or what are we looking at there? Well, that looks like a drawing or a painting, right? Well, that is a painting. This was a painting right here that kind of said, okay, I got to pay attention to this artist because at first glance, I find his stuff crude. But then when you look at it closely and look at each of his pieces, then you're like, oh, wait, there's a method to this guy's madness. And yes, it is comic related because it still involves imagery and text and the story that's being told in each of these pictures. J.D. Kirby's your dude. Well, he's not harassing you, so of course he's your dude. All they do is yap and lick each other's butt. No, you don't know that. You don't know that. You absolutely don't know that. I'm here giving a dissertation on an important artist, and you're here making homosexual jokes about my dogs. I should take your ranch and ban you. At the very least, push your way to Sci-Fi Nation's channel. You want to go to Sci-Fi Nation's channel, Jabba? You'd be great there at Sci-Fi Nation. Oh, I mean, no, Jabba. They're my happiness. They're my best friends. They're absolutely not. Even Dillard says, I'm important to him because I matter. I'm an important voice in this community. You can't silence me forever. I won't let you. Bear says, are your dogs your furry B-days? They wash your butt. No, they do not. You know what Sci-Fi Nation is. You don't know. We all got familiar with the Phantom Rejects. You can't tell me you don't know who he is. We all know who he is. Maybe one day. Oh, you know what I'll do on stream one day? And this is unrelated to the topic today, but I'll just throw this out there. I may do a stream because there was a stream that Testify was on with Rosetta and Sci-Fi Nation. It's actually one of the best streams I've ever seen, but it was on Rosetta's channel, so most people didn't get to see it. But I have it. I think I might EFAP it. I think we'll just watch it together and EFAP it, just to appreciate the genius as well as the tender side of Testify. But that's for another day. I don't want to get too much into it. Yes, J.D. Kirby, Braden K. Fave to say, consider backing B-Citizen Road Warrior Drake. What is B-Citizen Road Warrior Drake? B-Citizen Road Warrior Drake is my second graphic novel in the continuing adventures of Road Warrior Drake. So if you go to this right here, roadwarriordrake.com, go to roadwarriordrake.com, and then it'll take you to the website where the book is being funded. Be Citizen Road Warrior Drake. So you can go there and back a copy of the first book, the second book, both books, the ash cans. There's plenty of tiers. You pick the one that's best for you as long as you get the books. That's important. That's a picture of a detractor, says Compop. Oh, I see what you did there. It is one tractor, indeed. Let's see. Can I enlarge this, I think? Let me see. Yes, okay. So, yeah. So, I was observing this picture. Okay, so this is actually my picture that I took of this drawing, this painting. You can see how it has a little, definitely a little comic appeal to it. And I was drawn to it because of the text. The way the text was integrated into the picture. And it doesn't... It encourages you to observe both the image and the text as one. So the text becomes part of the artwork of the piece here. And I was drawn to that. This piece, by the way, is... what's this piece called? It's called The Big Push. From 1980. The artist is Howard Finster. Who is Howard Finster? Well, Howard Finster is one of the more famous or influential pop artists. And some of you may not know him, which is fine because I didn't know much about him until early this year. But his stuff actually was very influential in pop culture. I'll give you some examples. I bet you didn't know that he designed a lot of the album covers that we're familiar with today. I'm going to sneeze. Give me 1 second. Oh, shit. I think I'm going to sneeze one more time. Give me one more. Oh, crap. All right. So, yeah, Howard Finster did a lot of album covers. His most famous was The Reckoning by R.E.M. from 1984. Let me see if I can click on it. There you go. So that was Howard Finster. His album cover for R.E.M., the same group that did Losing My Religion. This was done in April 16th. It was released April 16th, 1984. But it was designed by Howard Finster. Can we enlarge it even more? Let's see. I can't enlarge it, but yes, I can. Because I can just hit the control. As you know, it won't enlarge it. Okay. It's fine. Unless I do the, can I do the image? Let me see. No, I can't do the click on the image. It's fine. It's cool. I say it's cool. Okay. So he did that album cover. He also did a Little Creatures for Talking Heads. You guys remember Talking Heads, right? If you don't, they were a pretty niche group in the '80s, but they were fun. They had a lot of songs that I liked. Well, not a lot, just a couple, but they were fun. But if you remember, if you're as old as I am or older, you should remember this album cover. And yeah, this is the album cover that Howard Finster drew and painted. And what else did he do? He did a lot of other album covers too. Also for Talk, he did a couple for Talking Heads. Yeah, he did this one here, The Road to Nowhere. That was from 1985. And then there's The Lady Don't Mind, Giving Back My Name, also from 1985. So these are album covers for singles that were released by Talking Heads. So when you got the individual vinyls, these were the album covers that and I love the fact that artists would do album covers for singles. It almost made the singles themselves collector's items. Well, not almost. It did make them collector's items. Here's another one for Talking Heads. And she was. So imagine owning this when you bought the vinyl or even bought the cassettes. I remember when I used to buy cassettes. Those were fun times. Maybe not because I didn't have as much range to music as I do today. So I guess I don't miss it as much. I talk about it with nostalgia, but I don't really miss it as much because I love the fact that I can have access to lots of variety of music that I've never had access to. Continue on in the chat for a second. Suzanne Eckstein says, Are your dogs little designer dogs? Well, they're my therapy dogs. They keep me company. They keep me happy. They keep me from going to the post office. They keep me happy, Suzanne. They keep me happy. By Dr. Memgla? Memgla? I don't know. Well, thank you. Oh, that was when I sneezed. Well, thank you, Suzanne. I appreciate that. I appreciate the belatedly acknowledging that you said bless me as I let loose my soul after I sneezed. JD Kirby giving summary synopsis for Beast Citizen Road Warrior Drake. There's a synopsis right there. Yes, absorbing both the feedback from the first graphic novel. It was the right time to write and draw the sequel and go deep in Road Warrior Drake's relationship with the war-ridden province of Skullkill. Yes, I seek to every day improve my skill, my craft. Let me go ahead and show the campaign for a second. Beast Citizen Road Warrior Drake. I already have a couple of contributors already. So people that missed out on the Indiegogo, the Funmic Comic, and the Kickstarter, there's still time on the crowdfunder here. Again, the URL is roadwarriordrink.com, or you can just did I pin it? I don't think I pinned it, right? Of course not. Why would I do such a thing? Why would I pin the link to the crowdfunder on my own chat? That would imply I had reasonable skills. Well, anyway, the message is pinned on the chat. That's the link to the crowdfunder. If you haven't backed a copy, you should do it. It's fun. And you're going to appreciate the style that I put into the story being told in this book. And yeah, I'm actually going to talk about a little bit about style and art in a little while. I want to just get through Howard Finster first. But yeah, this is what you'd expect from the interior of the book. And if you've been following the series, the YouTube series that I've been doing the last few weeks regarding these indie artists, comic book artists, you can appreciate the style with which I'm bringing to this book as well. You can definitely appreciate the style as well as the designs of each panel. And of course, there's the first book, which is also available in the campaign. There's the ash can as well. So this is the ash can featuring a nice long cat fight between Pumpkin Warpatch and Ragnar. Little cheesecake there. And there's an image from the first book if you didn't get a chance to back the first book. So you can get the first two books. You can get the first two books with the ash can. You can get the paperback. You can get the hardcover copy. I love hardcovers. I'm a big fan of hardcovers. That is the ultimate sell for me. It's just if you get me a hardcover, I just may buy it. So that is how you get me. If you have a book that I'm on the fringe of buying, if it's a hardcover, I'm pretty much going to buy it. So a little life hack there. So yeah, I was looking at this. I was showing you guys this. I showed you my photo of it when I took it at the museum. This is from the Philadelphia Museum of Art. This is their synopsis of this piece here. And it's called The Big Push, number 176.5. Now, the thing with Howard Finster is this. He was a Baptist minister. Now, a couple weeks back, I talked about Lynn Ward and his father being a Christian socialist and how Lynn Ward had a lot of socialist leanings in his art pieces. Beautiful as they were, but some of them were, you know, it was influenced by his socialist leanings. But you could appreciate what it was he was trying to create there. Howard Finster, though, was a real hardcore Baptist minister. No socialism on his end. I think he was pretty much more into capitalism because, as you can tell, he was doing album covers for a lot of famous rock bands. But his story was that he was inspired by God to spread the gospel through a series of drawings and paintings. He gave himself a number of paintings he was going to do, and he exceeded it by thousands. I think that the number was like over 46,000 pieces of art this guy did. And in each of his pieces, he threw in like pieces of the Bible, or, you know, other texts that were thrown in there as well. And it was insane. Like he and that's why you see the numbers when you go to his art pieces and you'll see number 176.5. That's because he was numbering them because he was trying to meet a quota with how many pieces he said he was going to produce in his lifetime. And he exceeded it by a tenth of thousands. He did more than he said he was going to do. So this was number 1,765 of the art pieces that he did in his life. And I love the vibrancy of the colors on this one. And you can see he discusses like, but let me show you my because I can actually enlarge it on the photo that I took so we can read it together. Let me go ahead and share my photo because I can't switch over tabs from the browser to the photo app. So there we go. Now let's read it here. So it says here on the right, it says the angels can see the power of God. Earth people should also see God's power today. I'm not sure if he had a proofreader. I don't think he had a proofreader. I don't think he cared, but I definitely don't think he had a proofreader. Or maybe it was just a stream of consciousness. The angels can see the power of God. Earth people should also see. Yeah, I think he meant also one L, but he wrote two L's. So I don't know if, I don't know. But yeah, we should all see God's power. Power of December 23rd, 1980. That's what it says here in the wheels here. The Big Push, which is the tractor here. A tractor. But you can see what he does with the words. He puts them on the bottom here. And he kind of aligns it with the rest of the image. So it becomes part of the image. This is the thing that I liked about Howard Finster. Here's another piece here. This piece right here is called, what's this piece called? I'm going ahead a little bit, but let me, it's here. Let me see. Let me see what that one is called. That's on the Philadelphia website as well. That one is the, it's called Quit Blowing Your Horn down there. And I'll show you guys the blur from the Philadelphia Museum website as well. But this is my picture you're looking at. Let me go to that website so you can read about it first before we actually read the actual words on the image itself. So you can see that I didn't make it up when I talked about the names of the pieces. So quit blowing your horn down there. Don't you see my hands are full? This is the 2,118th art piece he did in his life. So he had already done 2,117 by the time he did this. And you can see it almost looks like a news comic strip, like a news strip, because you got the succession of the panel, the images, you got the text that accompanies it. And again, he points the text within the image as opposed to outside the image. To me, visually, it just looks nicer. I like how it visually looks. Before I read what it says, let me go to the chat for a second. Geek Avenger says, Psycho Killer, say, qua, fa, 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 fa. Better run away. There are tiny dogs, and they're protected. I'm going to protect it from these people because you're not going to come after my dogs. I don't own a purse, Bear. I don't own a purse. I'm a man. I have a wallet with an American flag on it. I don't do purses. I don't do purses at all. The link is not pinned. I just pinned it. Yes, I know, Shifter. I know. I know I'm reading this well after I already pinned it. So I know. Before I pinned it, not after. Suzanne's got real life stuff. Well, Suzanne, I hope you take care of it. I hope you come back in one piece. Hope everything works out well. We are here for you. Yes, J.D. Kirby, there is Taco the Narc. Taco is one of the main villains in Beasts and Road Warrior Drake. You're going to tune in for that one. You absolutely. No, you're not here to harass me. I'm here to block you. I will block you. I will block you. I will take a drench away, and I will send you to Sci-Fi Nation's YouTube channel so he can continue to block you. Always. Harassment campaign has come in. Yeah, you know, you guys on Twitter have been very brutal. I'm going to document everything, and then I'm going to report you. It's going to be a lawsuit, and it's going to be discussed on the forums. And you're going to gain notoriety on the forums. All you people. All of these. Geek Avenger says, you're either a socialist or a Christian. Pick one. Socialism worships the state. Not only that, Geek Avenger, but if you remember, I don't know if you watched my Lynn Ward stream, but you have a lot of socialists that like to claim that Jesus was a socialist. But the problem with that is that it doesn't mesh well with the parable of the talents. And you remember the parable of talents. You get what you give. The more you get, the more you give, the more you get back. Socialism teaches everybody gets equal share, regardless of how much effort you put into it. That's socialism. But the parable of talents is very capitalist in nature. The more you give, the more you get back. There's no way around that. So that parable alone, as told by Christ, is proof that socialism and Christianity do not mesh. They cannot mesh. You are rewarded based on your labor. That is Christianity as per Christ. So you are rewarded based on the effort you give. See, I'm doing Howard Finster's work right now. See? So J.D. Kirby continuing with taking blurbs from the crowdfunder. He's giving you blurbs, folks. If you're in the chat, he's telling you what the crowdfunder page contains regarding the marketing of Beasts of Rory Drake. So read his lines. I'm going to just put it here. This is him describing the campaign and what you can get in the campaign for Beasts and Road Warrior Drake. So there you go. Read that. J.D. Kirby breaking character from harassing me just to promote my book. I don't know if this is passive aggressive, but he is not a socialist. Present tense, the parable vineyard workers is also proof he isn't. They all got paid the same amount, even though they worked different hours. Yes. Yes. Yeah. I mean, yeah. Again, proof. And not only that, but when he told the apostles that they had special seats waiting for them in heaven, that's kind of proof of a hierarchy. Socialism doesn't believe in hierarchies. Socialism doesn't believe in castes, caste systems, or statuses. But Jesus said to the apostles, there are going to be special seats waiting for you. Not everybody in heaven is going to be treated equally. So that you know, there's no, socialism is definitely not Christian at all. Anyway, well, I mean, we're discussing a little Christianity, but it jives in with the theme of this, of today's spotlight with the artist, because Howard Finster was a Baptist minister and his artwork was totally influenced by his Christian leanings, his Christian faith. He had believed that he was called on by God to put the gospel out through his artwork. So this one right here, this piece is called Quit Blowing Your Horn Down There, Don't You See My Hands Are Full. This was done in 1981. And he did this, it was paint and glitter on plywood. An artist frame made of Douglas fir branded with art made metal stamps. So this was done on plywood. So I'm going to go now to my photo of the same piece, because I can then zoom in and we can see the text for what it says. So let's see. Here it is. Okay. So there is my photo of the same piece right there. And let's see. Let's start with the... So you can see some of the churches here. You can see him describing what these things that are hanging on are. And you can see like words written on there. The Army, the Navy, and the Marines, all their staff to defend the world of allies around the globe and to pass into something peace, bread, and good peace, bread, and goodwill. Some of the text is a little hard to read because I guess I should have went in closer when I took the photo. But it's also, yeah, you have to really be there to read, be able to read it, because some of the writing is very crude. But if you notice how you just filled in the words, how you fill in the words inside the boxes or inside the circles, it's a nice aesthetic. And I'm going to show you more examples of this from other artists. I love that. I love the way he just brings in the words and the images together. It becomes one piece. This is what he wrote. He says, the church, this is Howard Finster's writing, the church is not on Uncle Sam's shoulder. The church keeps more people out of prison than the law does. That is so true. The church can make it without Uncle Sam, but Uncle Sam will never make it without the church. That is very true. The old Uncle Sam that I know has never burdened the church with taxes, and we don't need, he's misspelled need, but we don't need any new Uncle Sams when we have the best Uncle Sam in the world. Uncle Sam must be the facts of the truth. The church does not produce criminals and wars. Uncle Sam has always dependent on the church to communicate to God in our nations. In our nation's crises of war, there's only one real Uncle Sam. Please don't vote him out. If you do, you will be on your way out. So if I'm not mistaken, this is probably a call against globalism. Dead weight that's been okay. Or maybe it's just referring to taxes. I think it's just taxes. Yeah. So this is a very interesting piece by Howard Finster. That definitely looks like it'll belong. Oh wait, there's more here. Let's go to the bottom here. What does he say here in the bottom? He says, you see, this is him describing the art piece. It is not us who is in the Cadillac that is blowing at Uncle Sam. It is the little man who is behind us who is blowing for Uncle Sam to move over. In fact, we are trapped between Uncle Sam and the little man. Uncle Sam takes his own time and the little man is rushing, so that puts the middleman on the spot. Although we have the Cadillac and yet we can't make a move, the question is, who is to blame? Howard Finster from the backseat is saying we will all have to move together. He is the world's minister of folk art, churchman of visions. This is his 2,118 paintings. So you had better do exactly what I am saying now. Okay, so he's a little, you could say he's a little, I know some people want to say eccentric, but, I could understand people saying, oh, that guy's a bit on the bubblegum side, kind of.
I wonder what the planes mean, says Comp Pop. Well, let's see. I mean, let me look at it again. Here's the planes right there. Okay, let's see. So Uncle Sam has to make all the money, right? And the Army, the Navy, and the... Okay, I read this already. I'm guessing this is a reference to war. Because he mentions war and the Army and the Navy and the money that is being used to keep a peace. And he say that the church is the pillar of the country. My words, not his, but he said it's not the church that sends people to prison. It's the country, the nation, the government. So Gigavin says law only works for those who can morally govern themselves. Benjamin Franklin, Gigavin, how dare you bring truth into this? How dare you? American history. We don't got time for American history here. We have CNN and MSNBC telling us what we want to hear. We don't need pesky history and the Constitution to tell us. So, everyone has fallen asleep, says Jabba. Good. That means that nobody's harassing me. I'm glad. I'm absolutely glad. So, Comp Pop says, a little schizophrenic. So, he said he had a vision and he's acting on that vision. And you know how when men have a vision from God, or they say they got a vision from God, and they feel it's their burden and their calling to go out there and push it out there and go to the ends of the earth and proclaim it. And that's what's happening. So, yeah. So that's what it is with Finster. So continuing on. Okay. Oh, this is a lovely piece. This piece is not a... This was at the museum as well, but it's not on their website. But this is his painting on Jesus. And his entire robe is the text of scripture, of all Jesus' sayings. This is all the quotes from the Bible of Jesus' sayings in the robe that Jesus is wearing here. Some of the most famous ones, of course, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. The thing you notice about Finster is he likes to misspell his words. Like when he spells need, he spells it with K-N-E-E-D. Here he spells alone with A-L-O-A-N. So it's weird. I don't know if he had a... If he was deliberately misspelling it, or if he was just, I don't know. Definitely could use the proofreader. But a lot of the famous quotes by Jesus adorning his robe here. Let me just zoom back out a minute. There you go. So it's very... this one definitely caught my eye. It was this piece here that made me say, okay, I'm going to have to do some research on this guy. Something about the way he puts the words together. See, this is piece number 2198, The Words of Jesus Only, by Howard Finster, 1981. This one's a fun piece. This is a dinosaur, and the scales are faces. This is actually pretty creepy. I think this is also painted on plywood. He painted each individual scale with faces. And he wrote this: all judgment that has come upon this world was wicked because of wicked people down through the ages. By all examples of sin, the world faces the crossroads of time. We are now at our last chance. The next 10 years, it is now time for a world's change, or the end of this world. If no chance, the world and the works thereof will burn up and will no place. You can see how he tried to cram his words into the box. This is his credits here. If the world will follow the rules of God, it could be like heaven on earth. His rules are not grievous, and they can qualify you. Qualify? They can qualify for heaven. Understanding is the world's greatest need. Just know how to get to heaven and how to stay out of hell and how to... to pilot a jet plane, and how to avoid a war, how to raise your family, how to be a doctor, how to run a government, how to be healthy, how to live. Yeah. Time for you, we spit well. You can see that he in cramming his words into his boxes, there was a lot of breakage, some insanely some typos, not typos, misspellings, because these aren't typed. These are actually handwritten. People and time come together for the birth. People and time together travel together. Earth time has no guarantee. Wow, he really did a lot of misspellings, didn't he? I wonder if he just like, I can't say he didn't read because he knew how to write, but that's just crazy. He did a lot of misspellings on his words. There is no guarantee Earth time can be taken. Earth time can be made longer or shorter, even by you. Time is coming in every moment, also going by every moment. One great thing about time, you can use it to profit, to be saved, to do good, to stay out of hell. You can use time until it passes. But make no mistake that the gospel of salvation is the death, burial, resurrection of Jesus Christ. Not to get too hammed up on religion, but I am a Christian, so you know I know what I'm talking about. But I love this piece with the dinosaur and the warnings of the ending of time. And it's amazing because you can remember all the dinosaur movies that came by in our film history, and it's like dinosaurs, the remnants of the past. Used to be the warnings of our future, and the remnants of ancient beasts becoming the instrument or the symbol of nuclear annihilation, the end of our people. Jabba's right about your dogs and beard. No, he's not. Stop listening to Jabba. Stop listening to him. They look like peanuts. Well, they are definitely weird. They're absolutely weird, but. It brings a lot of it brings a lot of character to this piece. So, but yeah, that was one of my favorites. This is one of my favorites when I saw that. People and time come together. This was the 16,977th painting he did in 1990. He did this. So this is an explanation for it right here. He says. Harfins believe that there were somewhere in the evening of the last days and felt like a second Noah tasked with warning of an impending apocalypse. His painted dinosaur is surrounded by many such warnings. Finster dedicated himself to art. After experiencing a religious vision at the age of 60, producing tens of thousands of paintings. This one is 16,977. In the 25 years that followed, Finster said that while painting a bicycle, he saw a face in his paint smudge on his finger that told him to paint, and the motive of thumb-shaped faces recurs throughout his book. Thumb-shaped faces, so that's what this is. So again, the scales represent the faces here. So you can see why I chose this as my thumbnail. So but yeah, that's just a few of the pieces that were at the museum that I went to see. And again, like when I saw that, when I observed the way he put together the art and the text, my thing was, I gotta do that with my book. I gotta put the image and text together that way because it visually looks nicer. It's a nice aesthetic to it. And I'm gonna pick some examples for you guys to see. So I have two examples, some hard copy examples of stuff that I have. Let me just pull it out here so you can see what I'm talking about. And one of these artists, I'm actually going to showcase sometime down the road. So this means I got to put my camera on. So let me remove this and put my camera on. I'm going to use the USB camera because I like it better. I don't like looking at the camera. So I'd rather just show you. But here's my copy of The Bolt of Horror. Okay. And I like the way the image and the text just blend together here. You can see that each space is utilized. The text has room on each panel, and it just gives like a nice little aesthetic to it. There's that pesky word, aesthetic. The way I use aesthetic. Also, what's missing today in many of our books is the lively text. The way text is just brought to life and become its own character, in addition to the image and the art that's already on display here. So. Let me see here. What's another example? Here's another nice little page of art and text put together. And if you remember earlier, I showed the Von Bode book. Same thing with the Von Bode book, with the Cheech Wizard. But now here's another example. This is a very obscure example, which is why I'm going to do this guy sometime down the road. But Fletcher Hanks who's Fletcher Hanks. Fletcher Hanks was a comic artist from the late 30s, early 40s. He was contemporaries with Bob Kane and Joel Siegel for Superman. And he was credited or uncredited. I'm not sure what it is, but he, for all intents and purposes, brought to the mainstream the first female superhero in Fantoma. She predated Wonder Woman by about 6 months, but he does the same thing with the art and the text. He just puts the text within the art. Even the word balloons. Like, the word balloons are hand-drawn. And you can see how it wraps the words. It doesn't leave space around the words like the manga does. When you see the manga word balloons, they have the space around the words. He doesn't do that. He draws the word balloons around the text, and it actually it hugs the text. So that the text becomes a part of the image. Your eyes doesn't really understand it, but you just know that when you look at it, it's almost like one piece. It comes together as one piece. Here's another good example of it. This is Fantoma right here. Okay. The first female superhero, unofficially, predates Wonder Woman by about a few months. Again, look at the text. Look at the how it goes together with the imagery. So it's almost like one piece. But that's not why I'm going to platform this guy soon. I'm going to talk about him for different reasons. Let's just say that his artwork was considered very crude at the time. But he was also one of the first artists that actually put backgrounds in his panels in this time. If you ever look at the old Superman or Batman comics, they didn't always have backgrounds in your panels. But Fletcher Hanks was one of the first to do that, despite having a crude artwork. Let's see. We have some more activity in the chat. Hail Peanut Lord Crane says Manticore with the abuse. I don't deserve that abuse. And he's continuing with the emoticons. The evil emoticons. Hail the chat, he says. Here's Matt Bar 6 says, Hail Manticore. With the combat says, oh, cool colors. Yeah. Oh, I love the vibrant colors. I do. It brings the imagery to life. Hail says Billy Powermax. Hail to you. Hail to you. So yesterday, a couple of days ago, I had spoken with Dark Gift, and what's going to happen is he's going to do his cockfight streams every other Thursday starting next week. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to stream for an hour before his stream starts. So I'm going to cram in as much material as I can, you know, give a lot of meat into my stream. And then that way I'm not streaming over him. Or if I stream over him, I'll do like 10, maybe 20 minutes tops over him, and then cut the stream short. So, and I may or may not do the co-host thing with him. I'm not sure yet. I haven't decided, but I am slated to go against Narwhal. I think that's episode 2 of Cockfight. So you will see me and Narwhal going on a draw off. It'll be interesting how that goes down. So it'll be fun. It'll be absolutely fun. And it's good. It's art related, and I'm looking forward to it. So. But yeah, Howard Finster, to me, like the aesthetic of how he put together words and image, that's something that I wanted to do for my book. And I actually changed it up quite a bit, because when I was doing the word balloons for my book, you know, I was doing the traditional comic style, but then I said, you know what? There's something to the way he's doing it with his, and how he makes the words and the image appear as one entity. So I started to go back and redesign some of the word balloons, and I made the conscious decision to make Road Warrior Drake's word balloons hand drawn. That way, I can fill each word inside the balloon, and it's almost like, you know, you get those sacks that has the vacuum pack where you put something inside a plastic bag and you seal it up, and then you suck the air out of it with a vacuum. That's kind of what I'm doing with the word balloons with Drake's dialogue. It's going to help make the image a bit more, in my opinion anyway, aesthetically pleasing. Manticore says, you are punching above your weight class there, Peanut. I know. What's wrong with me? What's wrong with me? Impressed, though. Well, thank you. Thank you. Geek Avengers running an errand out to do something in meat space. So We wish him well on his errand to do things out in meat space. Now, I talk about my book and what I'm doing with the text. Let me see if I can pull up an example so you guys can see what I'm trying to do. Let me see if I can pull up something right now, a good example. So without giving too much away, let's see. What's a good example? Should I show this page? That's a good page, right? Let's see. Well, this is a good page. I'll show this page. Let me show this page. I think this is probably a decent example of what I'm talking about. Oh no, this one. This is the page I want to show. Page 10. Let me show you page 10 of B Citizen Rotary Drake, so you can see an example. And not every page is going to be this way, but this is an example of a good example of what I'm talking about. So let me enlarge this here. So you see with the word balloons, I don't give word balloons like 1 inch space around the text. I feel like that just obscures the art. One of the complaints I got from the first book was that the word balloons were translucent. And for some reason, people were upset by that. They didn't understand the translucency of the word balloons. They understood why it was there, but I guess they felt distracted by it. So there's not going to be translucency this time around. But what I'm doing with the word balloons is I'm not going to keep like 1 inch borders around the text. I'm going to wrap it as close as I possibly can without obscuring the words so that the text becomes a part of the image itself. And you can see how I try to design it so that the word balloons have their space in the image without obscuring too much important detail on the image themselves. You know, I do things with the fonts so that the fonts have a distinct style when it's narration versus dialogue. And again, try to fit as much words into a particular box without giving too much space in the box. And sometimes I don't use boxes. Sometimes I just put the text out freely because it just adds a bit more variety. And one of the things I'm trying to go for is variety with text so that, it becomes artistically – it adds a visual art aesthetic with the text. So now the text themselves become artistic. They become an artistic tool. Even up to the sound effects. So when you go back and look at it, you get a lot of activity. Your eyes look at it and say, oh, there's a lot of action going on here. There's a lot of stuff going on. I have to sit down and observe it and pay attention to each page. And I'm going to do a lot more narration in this to kind of fill in the blanks that the dialogue doesn't explain so that I'm not adding unnecessary expository dialogue. I'm using the text more so this time around than I did with the last book to help tell the story. So Manicor says, they do suit the layout and the art for sure. Yeah, I think so too. I think visually I know for a fact it's going to look visually better than Street Champion Road Warrior Drake. Although both books are necessary for the overall saga. So I recommend getting both books if you haven't already. Might have to pick your brains at some stage on lettering techniques. Yeah, I mean, listen, lettering is very, it's very underappreciated. It's very underappreciated because we think of it as just word balloons and story. But what I've learned with Howard Finster and what I'm seeing with other books, other comic book books, especially comic books of yesteryear, more so than today, is lettering onto itself is an art form. And onto itself, it can be artistic and it can add to the cartoonish aesthetics of a comic book. So you're not just putting words on paper. You're actually designing the words, and the words themselves become the characters in addition to the literal characters you're seeing on page. That blew my mind when I thought about that. I was like, wow, that's mind-blowing. And I think about some books that could have been salvaged or books that could have been elevated with just text, with the lettering and the proper lettering. Who let Manicor in the door? Says, Manicor is simping for me. Let him vouch for me. He's actually validating what I'm saying. I feel validated, Carol. And you know what Manicor is not doing? He's not harassing me. So I feel validated. Manicor says, there is definitely an art and finesse involved. See, I'm glad you see it. Thank you. Yes, thank you. You see it. And that's great because that's what I'm going for. And again, I think people who will see this will appreciate that, yeah, you know what? This Elasmat guy's kind of upped his game a little bit. Wow, he's actually a... this actually looks much better than the first book, and it does a callback, a nice callback to some of the earlier comics, and I can see what he's talking about. Compop says, maybe right and left justify the text, fill the balloon. Yes. Maybe right and left. Oh, I see what you're saying. Right and left justify the text, fill the balloon. It depends. Some of it is left justified. Some of it is right justified. It depends. If I do a center justified, there's a reason why. So, but again, this is pending. So, guys, this is pending proofreader, of course. I'm going to go through a proofreader, and they're going to go through the text, and they're going to tell me what works, what doesn't work, and then I got to go and change it up and make it work. So, for all intents and purposes, like, with regards to text, this is like a first draft. So, you know, I'll probably get somebody that'll look at it and say, hey, maybe you should indent this. And I'm like, okay, I see what you're saying. And that might involve me changing up words, adding more words, or taking away words. So metaphors on top of metaphors. I know, it's too much metaphor. It's like Inception. Bleh, bleh, says Carol. Well, thank you. Thank you not. Not yet. Anyways, of Manticore. Manticore, not me, but Manticore says, shut up, Carol. I didn't say that. I'm just reading what Manticore said. Says I don't get super chats. Haven't you got a bridge to be working on there? Ooh. Carol says, shut up, Carol. Good comeback. That's an excellent comeback. Absolutely. So the follow-up remark was quite the comeback. See, I'm reading the back and forth in the chat, and I'm reading the harassment from the chat, the targeted harassment of my two little therapy dogs, and now I'm seeing the target harassment between members in the chat. Totally not cool. Not cool at all. So, okay. Disavowed. Carol, you're disavowed. You were disavowed. I'm taking a wrench away, and I'm not going to help you anymore. So this was the page that I was working on yesterday. I was drawing this on my stream yesterday, my boring stream. So the thing with these particular streams that I'm doing is I never get a chance to actually draw as I'm talking about the stuff because I guess I need to really concentrate when I'm drawing. So, oh, you don't have a wrench? Well, maybe I should give you a wrench and take it away from you. If I was more entertaining, the chat wouldn't harass me so much. If I was entertaining, you would still harass me because you get a kick out of my raising my voice and my blood pressure. So, don't gaslight me. That's the word, right? Gaslight. Is that the word? Gaslight. Yeah, that's the word. Don't gaslight me. That's the new buzzword. You Nazi. You SJW. You detractor, you every word that's been used up and down the block of Twitter that has lost its meaning, person you. I mean, I shouldn't do that. I shouldn't do that, no. Geek Avenger says you had to take the trash out. There's a lot of trash in the chat. Take them out. Take all of them out. So. I'm going to take a quick little music break, and then I'm going to address something on Twitter, which is in tune with the message that I'm giving here and the talk that I'm giving here. So let me play a music, and then I will go back and talk about something that I saw on the twats, on the twits. So enjoy. Okay, before I go to Twitter, let me just say more of the chat. Justice for Affinity says, you know, it's core. Well, on unrelated note, subscribe to Johnny Scab's YouTube channel. Unrelated. Trust me, bro, it's unrelated. So, okay, so let me find this tweet. I bookmarked it. So let's see here. Is it? Okay. I hate this thing that Twitter does not work. I click something on the bookmark. But I'm reading this because, okay, here it goes. I'm reading it because it goes in line with the theme of these streams that I do. So here we go. And then I quote tweeted, of course, but there we go. So they were talking about art styles, and Doug Snable's name was brought up here. Okay, so, and this one user, Rip Xbox 021524, he says, he was responding to this tweet by Kay Brady about art styles and all that stuff. And of course, you know, sending books out. Not a comics gay fan, of course. And this says, all Snable made was Earthworm Jim, Doug Snable. I have no clue why he has any relevance to comics. Washed up one hit wonder. This user says, he's made tons of comics that aren't Earthworm Jim, though that remains his most popular product. I didn't mean it literally. Most of his books have awful art to a point where I ignore their existence. The fact that Comicsgate even got money speaks a lot to the intelligence of the comic community, and that is not a compliment. His art is very Calvin and Hobbes-ish, probably owing much to how much he idolizes Bill Watterson. I don't think his art is bad. It's just ripe for the goofball stories he wrote. I've never been a part of Comicsgate, and as far as I know, Doug and Ethan have it out for each other. I guess, but compare his art to someone like EBS or Tom McFarlane. Doug is in a short bus lane compared to those guys. This right here was the reason why this mentality right here, this thinking right here, this is why I was doing these streams. This is why, because it's just, to me, it's elitist and very, very, I don't know, I guess entitled. It's an entitled thing, I guess, because just because I'm trying to figure out how to go ahead and address this. Because I quote tweeted it, and I'll show you guys what I said in the quote tweet in a second. But I want to just address it here verbally before I go to the quote tweet. But you know how? Okay, so you got Tomohiro or One, which is his name, the creator of One Punch Man. You got Charles Schulz, the creator of Peanuts, right? You got Jim Davis, the creator of Garfield. Chester Gould, the creator of Dick Tracy. Who else? I'm trying to think. Of course, Calvin and Hobbes. The Family Circle was another one. Heathcliff. Archie. Archie's another one. I mean, if those comics were drawn with the same style of a McFarlane, a Kirby, or EVS, or those comics probably wouldn't have been famous. They probably would have been enjoyable. They probably would have just been like, yeah, they're comics. But, and you know, you may not agree with Smiller, but he's not wrong here. He says, that's a stylistic choice. If Doug wanted to focus on detail for storytelling, he could tell. He could. But to him, it's a story that matters, and the art is there to serve the story. Yeah, it's about the art serves a story. It's not about the art has to look a certain way, or it has to look exactly like everybody else. It's, does the art being displayed serve the story being told? And that's one of the reasons why I'm doing these series, is to show these artists, these creators that would have artwork that would be rejected. Let's be honest. A lot of these creators would be rejected by Comicsgate and a lot of these other adjacent communities. Because this elitist mindset that, oh, if it doesn't look like McFarlane or Jim Lee, then it's shit. I'm like, no, that opinion is shit. That's a shit opinion, if you ask me. Very shit opinion. Manicore says, I'm pretty sure Earthworm Jim would have been self-insert, but that's another matter. Well, that's not, I mean, be that as it may, that's not the argument that's being had here. But it's about the style of artwork, and if Doug Snable is a talented artist because of that, or is lacking in talent, which is the guy's argument, which I find to be a very foolish argument. Giga Venge says, if he's not an artist, then he's an art critic. Art critics are parasites. Stanislaw Sokolsky, known for throwing a critic down a flight of stairs. Yeah, I think a lot of people that criticize art don't really understand it. They don't understand when a particular character or story depends on the art that's being used to tell the story. You know, if I drew my book like Karl Barks, it becomes a Karl Barks imitation, and it would undermine the story. Conversely, if I drew it like a Jack Kirby or Tom McFarlane, it would probably be boring because it'd just be a standard action story. I remember one time Dux Naple said something to me. Dux Naple was on a stream with Will Red a couple years ago. And it was on the stream that I was on. I was on there as a panelist. And then in the middle of the panel in the discussion, I just went to bed and just went to sleep. And while the panel was having a deep conversation about something, I was asleep. So it's crazy. But Dux Naple made a point, especially when it came to Road Warrior Drake. I don't know the exact wording of what he said, but it was to the point of you be the best version of your style will be the best version of your style. Something to that effect. His point being is that whatever your style of art is, make it the best version of that style. Make your style of artwork the best version of your art style. That's why. Soul Curioth, you know, I hope I'm saying your name right. If I'm not, please correct me and judge me. I accept judgment. I wonder why he's grouping Todd with EVS. Well, this is not the first person to do that. A lot of people that I've read on Twitter, a lot of comic fans have said that EVS style somewhat was inspired by Tom McFarlane. Whether it's true or not, I don't know. I'm not saying it is. I'm saying that's the mindset that a lot of fans have said, that EVS's art style in some ways is borrowed from Tom McFarlane. Although I personally don't see it. I personally don't see it, but a lot of people have said that. So I'm just saying that's what been put out there. I disagree, but I'm also not one of Tom McFarlane's biggest fans. I don't collect all his books, so I wouldn't know his art style aside from a few pages I've seen from Spawn and of course the infamous Captain America drawing he did with the big tits on him. He could definitely draw, says Manticore. Who are you referring to? EBS, Douglas Naple, or Tom McFarlane? Because I just threw out a lot of names there. So, but yeah, Dux Naple responded. He says that Todd has only praised my work. He wrote the foreword to my book Monster Zoo in 2008. Never mentioned your other guy while he was knocking off Todd. See, even Doug says it. That even Doug is of belief that Ethan is taken from Todd's art style. For the record, Todd's work of Spawn when it first came out was criticized by Smooth Brains as too cartoony. That you have no grasp of comic history is no doubt due to your expertise in YouTube comic fandom. Go buy some tapes and come back to me. So I'm not saying this in as harsh a tone as Doug is, but I agree with him. A lot of people that came into the 90s Image Comics, the Valiant Comics of the 90s, and they fashioned themselves as comic fans, I don't think they understand. I don't think they understand that there is a whole history of comics that deal with weird art styles, like Tomohiro, for example, as I described, or Von Bodhi. And there's going to be more people that I'll be showcasing down the road. So, yeah, absolutely. So I don't disagree with him there at all. And, you know, I chimed in, and, of course, I plugged my stream. I said, this right here is why I'm doing my Thursday weekly art streams. There's a flawed consensus. Yes, this is a flawed consensus that only one style of art is good. There is such a thing as style, and it can range from Jack Kirby and Alex Ross to Bruce Timm. It can range from Gerhard to Von Bodhi. So, yeah. So, and again, it's preference it plays a key as well. So, but yeah, this is why I do these streams. This is exactly why this consensus that's out there is why it's there. There is various books and characters and worlds out there that attest to the fact that, hey, different art styles are appreciated. It just is. So some of Ethan's style almost has a graffiti feel to it. So does Von Bodhi. You know, it's funny. Okay, because Von Bodhi and Ethan don't have the same art style, but look, they both inspire graffiti art. See, again, it goes back to my point. It goes back to my point, exactly. So Compop says, you have to review Jimmy Corrigan, The Smartest Kid on Earth by FC Ware. It will blow you away. I'll put that on the list because I am looking at new people to look at. I have more names I'm going to be spotlighting down the road. So that will be one person that I'm going to look at. So definitely. Hold on here. Let me close this down here. Let's see here. Close that. Gosh, my throat is already dry. Oh, dry throat. Okay. So yeah, Jimmy Corgi. I'll look into him down the road. So there we go. All right. Going back to the chat here. Let's see. What am I doing? I am showcasing artists, comics, and styles that have been neglected by a community that would rather just talk shit for hours upon end with unplayable content as opposed to doing content that a lot of people want to see of replay value and to learn and to grow and to benefit from, in addition to taking harassment from the chat over my dogs who are not gay. They're not gay. Compop says, his style is so unique and amazing. Yeah. Yes, absolutely. Words are hard, says Wiggle. Yes, words are hard indeed. They're absolutely hard. I totally agree. Yes. I think he's talking about art nuances, but I could be wrong. Possibly, yeah. Absolutely. So we have the Wiggle sighting in the chat. Absolutely. And a total of 48 beautiful people watching the stream. So this is great. This is absolutely great. We're at 9:12. We're at 1 hour, 21 minutes into the stream. So I'm probably going to call it here. I have enough content, I think, for replay value and for people to enjoy. For those that didn't get to see the live. No, they're not troons. They're my therapy dogs. They're my happiness dogs. How dare you? How dare you? So, Hail Manticore and Artifice and Reanimate says Geek Avenger. Yes. Geek Avenger, my resident pallbearer. Not pallbearer. What do they call those people that greet people in the church? I forgot what they call them again. I've been out of church for such a long time. I don't know what they call them. I will end it on my time, Wiggle. I will absolutely end it. So, but yeah, I think I'm going to end it here now. But it's great. It's great that every time I hit the like button, I'm like, well, I have enough content to put in at least an hour's worth of work. And I always do, and it's great. And I hope that people, you know. Okay, Mr. Rocket says, you need to guide me away from well-read. From the well-read talk content. Why? Guide me away from what? To the usual people going on stream, shouting at each other and talking shit and just driving people away who don't want this shit. Because you know who I care about, right, Rickus? I'll tell you who I care about. I care about the paying customers that want comic books, not the ones that go to a shit show and don't buy comics, but they want to see a community burn. That's what I go for. I go for the people that actually care about comic book content, that want to buy shit, that want to be entertained, edified. The key word is edified, right? Edified, learn and grow and get an appreciation for the arts. Because at the end of the day, I'm an artist, I'm a storyteller. So that is what I want to do. I want to sell a story and a IP and content. And there's a lot of people in this community that are pissed off with what's going on right now. And you know what I'm talking about. They're pissed off with what's happening and with customers going away in droves, with the drama and shit. There's a growing number of people that are tired of it. I'm tired of it too. But you know what I'm going to do? I'm actually going to do something about it. And what I'm going to do is actually put out streams that are informative in addition to entertaining, streams that have content that you can watch at a replay, because that way you feel like you're missing something. You know, you could hear about a shit show that happens in a 4 or 5 hour stream, miss it, and not bother to watch it because you've heard it before. But you go to a stream that has content that has some value to it, you want to go back and watch it on the replay. That's what I care about. And I think a lot of people are done with it and they want something different. And judging by the comments in the chat, see, judging by the comments here, there's a massive agreement on it. And these streams have gotten over hundreds of views as a result of it. And the engagement on Twitter, although the replies on Twitter aren't that they're not as active on Twitter, but they're watching it. Because I have on my StreamYard a total of 47 people watching right now. That's a good number for me. Geek Avenger says, a lot of them have some good stuff going on upstairs and that melon of his. I went from peanut head to melon? How did I do that? How did I go from melon head? See, Wiggle can do a shit show because he's perfect at it. See, Wiggle's perfect at it. He gets the engagement. He gets the views. He's our resident shit show streamer. So I will fuck with Wiggle, totally. But I'm not Wiggle. I can't be Wiggle. I am me. And I sat down and I said, you know what? And this wasn't just something that I did within the last month. I've been thinking about this for almost a year with regards to live streams. I'm like, are my live streams the kind of streams that people will go back and watch over and over again, or will go back and want to watch it when they miss it? And I'm like, for a while, that's not the case. And that has been the case for a lot of CG streams or comic book streams in general. It's, you know, whether it's a shilling for someone's book that nobody's watching because show streams are boring as shit. We know that. They're boring as shit. Or the IBS, the blood sports that is now destroying the camaraderie in our community, that is destroying morale, that's pushing customers away and hurting book. And yes, it's hurting book sales. It's hurting a lot of books. A lot of CG books are down in sales. The customers are going away. They're walking away. They're done with this shit. They're done with the fighting. They're done with the fucking egos. They're done with being mad at angry black man for reasons. They're done with it. Customers don't. What we think, we got to pay attention to what the customers are saying. Not what the drama stores are saying, but the customers are saying. The people that actually put the money down to buy our books. What are they saying? I've listened to what they're saying. You know what they're saying? They're done with it too. And I'm like, okay, well, that is my audience. That is who I want to bring in. I want to bring those people in my circle because they like comics. They like art. They like stories. They like characters. And guess what? I have a character and a story that I want to sell too. I have a story and a character. Road Warrior Drake. I have an IP that I'm selling. You know, I have an art style that I'm improving upon every day, every month, because I take criticism to heart. The criticism is going to help me become a better person. And Geek Avenger, I got your DM, and I 100% on top of it, man. I got it. Don't think I ignored you. I didn't ignore you. I got you. Your words, I appreciate you coming out to me and telling me. I totally got you, man. Totally. But people are done with it. They want to be edified. They want to go to a stream and gain something from it. They want to learn something. They want to walk away with something and be a better person today than they were yesterday. They want to grow. They want to consume and grow. Nobody's going to consume and grow hearing 2 hours of just anger and jealousy and dividing people. Customers are done with that. Lord Peanuthead III says Manticore. People are done. No, they're going to come back. Don't get me wrong. There's a time and place for all of that. But every streamer shouldn't be doing that. Because then what? It's killing our book sales. Oh, no, there should only be one me. There should never be more than one me. I don't wish that type of torture on the world. I will not go back and watch this wiggle. I don't recommend you do. No, don't do it. Yeah. Don't do it. Are they going back? Oh yeah, as a matter of fact, let me show you. Hold on a second. I showed the numbers earlier in the stream, but I'll show you this. Hold on. I'm gonna go to my YouTube dashboard, right? Let's go to the dashboard, right? Here we go. So my top videos in the last 48 hours. Yesterday's stream, but that's because it was yesterday, so that's expected. But the last two streams, obviously the one I'm watching now, the one I'm doing now. And this one with the video of me getting slapped, that's always been like, that's always in the top three. But let's see here. Before I went live, it was the Lynn Ward stream was in the top three here. Before I went live. And then yesterday, it was the Lynn Ward, this video, and the Von Bode stream were my most watched in the last 48 hours. We go to the analytics. When I started doing these streams, it was last week in February. Since then, I gained 29 subscribers. 29 in 1 month in doing these kind of streams. I gained 30 subscribers. 30 subscribers came to my channel when I started doing these type of streams. Those are numbers I care about. In addition to that, I gained a new backer for Beast Citizen Road Warrior Drake. This is a crowdfunder that I didn't really promote because I already did most of my promotion on Indiegogo, on Kickstarter, on From My Comic. On the crowdfunder, I was just going to just leave it there. And if I talk to somebody, if it comes across and in passing, great. At least I can have a venue to sell the book. But new eyes are coming into my IP. New eyes are coming into my sphere. New eyes are checking me out. And this backer here, a couple backers here, were new eyes that came to my property. These are new people I'm attracting. And these are people that are legit just want comics. They want just to have fun with the comics again. Again, I don't mind a shit show. We once in a while we need it. Don't get me wrong, we need it. But every stream is either a shit show or a boring ass shill stream. And I'm done with it. And a lot of people are done with it too. And I'm bringing those people into the fold and I'm helping them with some kind of alternative. Man, of course, I'm watching it now, so I don't have to. Good man. Okay. Dogs and Housewives sleeping together, mass hysteria. That's the white girl fuck dog song right there. Yeah. I don't get it, Wiggle. What is with those? Okay, well, you know what? At least it's not a peanut emoji. I will do it. I think burnout for books is not being supplied. Well, that's a big thing. Okay, yeah. Good point. That's an excellent point. Absolutely. We give, and I say we as in, because I don't want to single out anybody, but you guys can fill out in your minds who we're talking about. But I'm going to say just we. We set up a deadline for books, and then time passes, and we don't get those books out. And people are like, you know what? Fuck it. I'm not interested anymore. I don't want to talk about it anymore. And that's also a big thing that kills morale in customers who would have backed our books. So a line doesn't concern itself with the opinions of people with sandy vaginas or something. Yeah, something happening. Wiggle says warehouse fire. Warehouse fire. Yes. Ah, my good friend Jack Stafford. A horny Nate, says Jack Stafford. Yes. Welcome, Jack. Welcome to the stream. Geek Avenger says, if we're going to speak out against degeneracy, we shouldn't let it in through the front door. I agree. Coom Sumer, says Wiggle. My good friend Wiggle, yes. Could you not bring people on to discuss this matter? I could do it on a separate stream. I don't want to use these specific streams. I don't want to do it for that. But if it's something that people want to discuss, I'm all for that. 100% for that. I'll fire up a stream somewhere. I don't know. If people want me to fire up a stream separately on this issue, maybe we can do it. But I'm only bringing it up because it kind of segued from what I was talking about earlier to this. So that's why I'm bringing it up. But I have to defend why I'm doing these streams. There is an audience for it. And that audience is growing my channel. It's growing my channel. And it's getting more eyes on my product. And that's what I want. So keep to your format and keep grinding. Absolutely. Hey, it's about the hustle, man. Manticore, you know this. A lot of creators don't want to do the hustle. They want to get on that cheap plane success. They want that quick cash grab. Meaning they if it's popular, they'll jump on that wagon because it gets them more money. But it doesn't build a long-term IP. I mean, I want to do this long-term. I don't care. Okay, so here's the thing, guys. I'm not making these books to make money. I'm not trying to make a profit on these books. I work a regular job. I have a regular job and a gig on the side. I pay my bills doing things not related to comics. I do this because I want to create the character. I want to create the book and tell the story and put it out there and say that I created a comic book. That's really what I care about. This is the case of money doesn't buy happiness. I'm happy just making this book, making the arc, the trilogy of books for Rory Drake, and saying I've succeeded. Because how many people in America don't get to fulfill their dreams? We live in a nation of taxpayers who haven't fulfilled their dreams. Very few do that. And I'm doing it. And I'm very thankful. And I'm grateful to the backers of my books who have invested their money in me to make that dream a reality. And a lot of them have spoken out and said, you know what? I just want to get back to having fun again on a stream. Keep it from being degenerate and just having fun and being about the art. And sure, we'll have a shit show once in a while. Sure, I'm all for that. Listen, I'm all for that. But I think we just need to have conversations about art, art styles, creators, books, comic books, history, to help bring us back into focus, to help put things in perspective of where we are, especially in this, because we are in the indie circle. This is the indie circle of comics. So a lot of this is relevant to the indie comic side of which we are a part of. The talking about art is what got me to watch more. Yeah, listen, I love talking about art. And I have hours upon hours of streams. So Corey, I hope I'm saying your name right, but I have hours upon hours of streams where I don't talk about art because I'm talking about stupid drama that other people are dealing with, or someone wants to come in and they want to, you know, cause drama, cause shit, whatever the case is. And then it becomes less about comics, less about your character, and more about the cheap laughs. And again, I am not against anyone having their fun. Totally not. Absolutely not. But I think that there is enough of just being able to sit down and learn as a comic fan, as a comic creator, and learn about the people, the creators of yesteryear. Like, again, Von Bode, One, R. Crumb, you know, guys like that paved the way for indie comics to be a thing. They paved the way for Eastman and Laird to get to the point where they became fucking millionaires for Ninja Turtles. If it wasn't for people like R. Crumb or Bode or Charles Schultz, if it wasn't for people like that, then we would never have had a success story like Eastman and Laird. And they proved it. Indie comics are more than capable of creating a dent in pop culture and influencing a slew of artists who realize that, you know what, I have a style and I could bring it onto the sphere, and maybe, just maybe, there's an audience for it out there that will invest in it and make it popular. I draw more while watching art streams. I love seeing new styles and artists. Well, Kama, I appreciate that. And I hope that these streams are giving you appreciation for that. Because one thing I want to do is, you may not draw like Ethan Van Sciver. You may not draw like John Maitland. You may not draw like Peter Gilmore. You may not draw like Dillard. You may not draw like, who was another good one? Caden White. You may not draw like any of those guys, but you know what? If you can be the best version of you, then do it and see what it gets you. You never know. Tomohiro created a One Punch Man. An entire manga community told him to fuck off. He said, no, fuck you, I'm doing it. And look, he's a freaking million. He's one of the richest creators in Japan. And he got to that point because he told a community that doubted him to fuck off. I'm going to put this out there. I'm going to put my style and my book out there. I'm going to make a dent. And he did. He made a dent. And now he has a community of fans that adore his work and adore the contribution to manga and comics. Geek Avenger says, I'm not going to back Frag again. Even if I get Black Frag, I might back Malin again if I ever get Godlike. So, Godlike looks good. I didn't back it, but I think that looks like one of Malin's best books. I backed Graveyard Shift 1. I didn't back any of the other Graveyard Shifts because the story didn't hook me. So I didn't back the others, but Godlike looks pretty good. So I'm almost at 5K views in the last month. You're a hack, says Wiggle. I know. Well, you know, wait a minute. You can't call me a hack. That's a soul attack. I take offense to that. I am not a hack. Well, I am, but for kayfabe purposes, I'm not a hack. So, Mr. Ruggan says, I think a topic on subject on art would be more interesting. Well, I am taking requests for streams like that. So, if you want, Mr. Ruckus, elaborate more on that. And if I understand what you're saying, I might fire up a stream at some point this week and do something like that. I think that's a good idea. I absolutely do. Because that's a good discussion to have, because it opens up a whole lot of arguments about what is good, what is bad, and if you're retarded or not for saying if something's bad when it's actually just a stylistic choice that makes it good. Let's see. None of it matters, says Wiggle. I'm going to disagree. I'm sorry, I have to disagree. I do. I really got to disagree on that one, because if it didn't matter, people wouldn't put money down on it. So it does matter. 100% matters. Build it and they will come. Yes. Yes. Build it and they will come. Christopher John says, where is my book? I'm not happy yet. I don't know. I don't even know what book you're talking about. You know what's funny? Wiggle says this is boring. David says this is boring. But I got 22 people watching. So I got people's attention. So it's not boring because I got people's attention. It totally, this kind of conversation does get people's attention. We just haven't, attempted it because some people aren't nuanced enough to do it because they can't put people to sleep. But look at the conversation that's happening in the chat. Geek Avenger says, you're starting to ramble. Oh. Like Kamala Harris? Oh. Damn. Maybe I should slow down, right? Ouch. Kamala Harris? Ow. Stab me in the back with a peanut. Ah. Artists will always congregate to create and argue no matter what. Well, that's why I don't mind being isolated, Compop. I don't want to argue with other artists. I'd just rather be a recluse. I'm happy being a recluse. I'm at peace being a recluse. Wiggle and Jabba gay-opping in the chat. I'm documenting what you guys are doing. You're gay-opping. You're gay-opping. The significance of the passage of time is when time passes, it is significant. Very significant. Yes. Okay, so Mr. Ruckus says, I will be a co-host on the Wiggles Pro Grifter Tournament 2024. Confirm, otherwise Wiggle will quaff, eat your dog. Is that a threat? If I don't co-host Wiggles Grifter Tournament, is that a threat to me? Eating my dogs? Well, you can't bully me because I'm your new co-host now, according to Mr. Ruckus Wiggle. So if you bully me, you're not going to have a co-host, and you're going to be without a show because we're doing the 2024 Pro Grifter Tournament for Wiggle. If you guys don't remember the first Pro Grifter Tournament, oh man, that's a story onto legends. Totally. Dark Gift is in the chat. So yes, I guess I'm gonna have to help with that, I guess. So I guess I will coast. I suppose indie comics have existed since the dawn of the genre. Oh, they existed in the cave paintings. Absolutely. There's always been cave paintings, and there's always been indie comics. Geek Adventures, just don't push him too much, or he'll be like Ralphie from the Christmas Story. Damn, that breaks some nostalgia. Oh, Carol's upset because Dark Gift is in the chat. Yeah, Dark Gift is here. I'm a little behind in the chat. Let me see. Shut up, Hua. Hua. Oh, that's references. That's, oh, you meant Hua. I said Hua. I said Hua. I thought that was a Kung Fu Yeah, but no, that's a Hua. 22 people watching on YouTube and 40 watching on Twitter. So this is great. Co-host means you can bring beer. You can get beer from the fridge. Yes. That means, Wiggle, you can take a piss break while I go ahead and kill your chat to sleep. That's what that means. Compop says, wash your matted furry suit, Wiggle. Yeah, please, wash it. Get rid of the sweat stains on it. I'm going to have to go down in the chat a little more. Testify is deity. So I don't know if you guys heard, but I'm going to do a stream where I do like an EFAP of a stream where Rosetta was streaming and she had Testify on. And that stream was a legendary stream that nobody saw. And I got to do an EFAP of that because I want people to see both the soft side of Testify as well as the usual Testify that we love. It's a legendary stream. That's how you got to deal with uppity psycho wenches, Manti. Dark Gift is red pilling Manticore live on chat. Did you get a copy of Godlike? No, I didn't back it. I didn't back it. And I know that he has a second chance campaign up for it, but I was like, I don't know because I didn't like Rage Rush 1. To me, it just felt like an incomplete story, so I didn't go ahead and back any more of his books. So, but it Godlike does look very intriguing. I would say that. So I was very. This is the kind of stream where you start getting hangouts with Dark Gift. Oh, if you notice, Java, I didn't put the link in the chat. This is the kind of stream where I will go from beginning to end. Because if I bring people on, it's going to go for 2-3 hours, and then that kills the replay value. So I don't want to do that. Darkus says, that's right, Jabba. Educate, journal, informative, and fun. Do a showcase about MC Escher, a good artist. I wonder who that is. I should find out. Educational. Okay, so you meant, that's what you meant. You meant educational. Educate, journal. Jabba, did you capture this? Darkus, at least make fun of Darkus when he does typos. Give me a break and go after him with this educational. So, yeah, check the chat out. Very engaged. I know what I'm saying. So curious. I know what I'm doing. I know exactly what I'm doing. I know what I'm doing when I'm doing these kind of streams. Yeah, trust me. It doesn't always have to be a drama show. It could just be, again, a fun conversation about art like we're doing right now. Jabba says, destroyed yourself with a typo. I caught it. Yes. Dark Gifts, you're in Jabba's doghouse now. Rest in peace, Dark Gifts. Done, says Wriggle, Mr. Ruckus. I did, says Dark Gifts. Go back to oblivion, Dark Gifts. yeah. Okay, so if I don't co-host Wiggles Grifter tournament, then my dogs are in danger of being eaten by the Quaff. So I am being extortionized to do the co-hosting duties there. Darkest of Jabba, you're gonna have to unsubscribe. No more drama on my channel. Oh no. Yes, Darkest is doing art streams now. He's doing the cockfight. He's not doing any more drama. What he's doing is gonna have two CG artists fight each other on stream with the pens. So yes, there's gonna be bloodshed, but it'll be artistic bloodshed. So yes. Let's see here. Oh, that hurt my heart. Oof. You're still a mod, says Jabba. It says Dark Gift. So you lied, DJ. Oh, see, so people are calling to the lies in the chat. Lies, lies, lies. You still Jabba, you still get to be mod even if you're not subscribed. I should know. I have 40 merchants. Oh man. Godlight looks like shit, says Matt Barr. I wasn't a fan of Malin's writing. That's why I didn't buy his other books. But you know, I don't want to see the guy fail either, because he you know, whatever your opinion of the guy is, he is hustling. He's putting books out. So just admit you're a broke ass and couldn't afford it, says Chuck Reardon. How many times, Chuck, do I got to say that I'm a pock? What do you think that entails when I say I'm a pock? Obviously, it entails that I'm at a financial deficiency, but I'm not going to say that quiet part out loud. I just want to, you know, just want to be validated. It gave me Highlander vibes, man. That's why I backed it. Yeah, I like the look of it. I really did. I thought God like looks like a good book. I'm concerned about backing it because I don't want the whole thing where it's like, oh, it's an incomplete story like the first Graveyard Shift was. That's what I'm worried about. I'm tired of books that are 48 pages and they can't tell a complete story within those 48 pages. Like I want a complete beginning to end story. I want to feel fulfilled when I read a book. So maybe when I hear reviews of it, about it, then I'll buy a copy once it becomes available somewhere. If the reviews affirm that it's a good story, complete, and a lot of shit happens, then yeah, I'll probably buy a copy. Darkest has come up. I'll be back streaming until Wednesday, so my vacation is still ongoing. Wait, at Wednesday at 10 o'clock is Some Lords, and Thursday 8 is episode 1 of Indie Cockfight. Is it at 8 or is it at 9? Dark, is that because I thought it was at 8. I mean, I thought it was at 9. So, because I thought I was going to do 1 hour of my stream, and then we would go into your stream. So, Matt Bauer fight at last, Matt. And we have Rake pilled him. Rake greater than Drake. Slum subs. Okay. Pen is mightier than sword, says Dark Gift. Yes, pen is mightier than sword. Absolutely. Going down in the chat, I'm just going to go check out more. I have wrenches on channels that I don't know about. That's the problem. Yeah. Let's see here. I'm scrolling down more. Matt Barr says, Rock and Roll Ninja is a full story. Yes, that we need more books of full stories. And yeah, if you didn't back it, I don't know if your boy Zach ever keeps extra copies of that book, but yeah, I definitely support books that have full stories. Totally, 100%. That's where I'll throw my money at, always. Don't call yourself a piece of. I didn't call myself anything. I'm a POC. I'm a person of color. I'm to be revered, cherished, and protected. This community needs me, Manicore. It needs me, and you guys need me too. Because if not, then you're gonna just have an army of whites like Dark Gift and Jabba. Giga Bench says, I gave up on your boy Zach when he started waffling about being confiscated. I tried listening to his videos, but I never saw what EBS saw in him. I think a lot of people are disappointed in your boy, for sure. But, you know. Let's see here. Scroll on more. Let's see here. Too many comments. I'm trying not to read too many comments, because if not, I'll be here till midnight reading comments. Oh, yes. You don't have a wrench in Yellow Flash's channel anymore. So that's the one channel where Jabba is wrench removed. So let's see here. Weird analogies and coughing don't make great. Oh, you're talking about your boy Zach. Oh, I was like, I don't cough. Like, but okay. Yeah, he. I miss the old your boy Zach. I miss those videos. I wonder if there's an archive of those old videos. Do you know where anybody can show me where there's an archive of the old Your Boy Zach videos? Because those are great. Especially when you did the comic book reviews and you ripped up the shit comics. I love those reviews. I miss those. I miss that Richard C. Meyer. But there's got to be some channel out there that has those old videos archived. So episode one's going to be at 8, then episode 2 at 8:30. Episode 3 will be at the normal 9 o'clock time. Okay, so we're going to have to coordinate this then. Because if I'm not streaming over you, then I'm not going to be able to do the Thursday then. So I'm probably going to have to push. No, because you're doing Slums on Wednesday. So is Scribattle? I know that the last episode of Scribattle happened. If not, I'll do my stream on Wednesday at 8 o'clock. And then I'll let that lead into a slum show on Wednesday. Let me know if that works for you, Dark. If there's no Scribattle on Wednesday, because I know that yesterday's Scribattle was the last episode of Scribattle. So if that Wednesday 8 o'clock slot is open, I'll do my art stream on Wednesday. I'm going to do that there. So just let me know. So what I'll do is this. I'll stream on Wednesday at 8, right? Because that's going to be an open slot. And then that way you could do Thursday from 8 on, and you don't got to worry about being streamed over or opposed, whatever. So you can do that with no competition. So I think that might work. So I'll probably do Wednesday, 8 o'clock, for my next art stream. And I'll have to postpone, because I do some live videos on a widows group in Facebook on Wednesday. So I may have to postpone that to do the art stream for Wednesday. So I just got to make arrangements, but I'll do that. So when are we holding? Oh, is that kayfabe? Probably kayfabe. Who knows? Well, we're almost on 2 hours. This chat went lit the last 30 minutes. We went up to like 22 viewers at a time. We got lit. Jabba says Dillard can't afford to keep Scribattle going. He only got 40%. Oh. Dark Gift says, yeah, that works. Not sure why we didn't think of that when we talked to the other. That's because I thought you were doing 9 o'clock. That's why, Dark Gift. Because I was under the impression from what you told me you were gonna do Thursdays at 9. And you know, it was gonna be every other Thursday. See, I thought it was gonna be every other Thursday at 9. And on those Thursdays that you were streaming, I was only gonna do an hour, and then I was gonna either go to an extra minutes and then cut it off to go into your stream, or just do a clean cut with the 1 hour mark. But I'll do the Wednesdays on the streams that you're doing on Thursdays for the 8 o'clock ones. Once you go to 9, I'll resume back to Thursday. But for the first two, which as you said, 8 and 8:30. I'll just stream on those Wednesdays, and that way you'll have that window successful to yourself. Another successful stream, allows me, says JD Kirby. Thank you, JDB. I forgive you for the night letters. I forgive you for the harassment on Twitter. I forgive you. I'm a Christian, so I forgive you. As Jesus said, forgive those that trespass against thee. You have trespassed, and I forgive you. Man, of course, says keep Scribattle out your mouth, cuck slug. I can't. It's already out. It's out in the ether. It's out in the atmosphere. I can't bring it back, Manticore. I can't do it. I can't undo what's been done. I don't have that kind of power. I'm just a pock. Carol Cullis, why does Dark Gift make everything so... I know, Carol. Why does he do... He makes everything so complicated. Dark Gift, why do you do that? Why do you make things so complicated? Why couldn't you just say, hey, Alaska, I'm doing the first and second episode at 8 and 8:30. Why don't you stream on Wednesdays at 8, which is not open? And I would have said, oh, you're right. I could do that. No, you didn't do that. I gave a long speech about how I was just going to do an hour on Thursdays and segue into your show, only for you to tell me, oh, I'm streaming at 8, which is my time. But no. See, you caused division. You caused chaos. You caused a conflict that didn't have to happen. You caused it. Rake is better. Night letters coming. Oh, shit. I'm not joking, folks, when I say that I keep getting that there's harassment. I'm telling you. I thought I mentioned the first two were going to be at odd times. But yeah, after episode 2, it will be 9 and every other week. Only the first two are consecutive weeks. Okay, so that means the next 2 weeks, I'll just stream on Wednesdays at 8. I'll do my art streams at Wednesday at 8. So I just got to remind myself to do everything a day early so that I'm prepared. So JD says, I'm humbled. Thank you. You're welcome. Shut up, whore, says Dark Gift with the New Jersey accent. New Jersey accent. Whore. Whore. Avenger says, I'll be back the next In Color project you're on, Matt Barr. All right, so I just gained Matt Barr Geek Avengers interest, so that's good. Well, I didn't gain it, but It happened on my stream, so. But Matt Bar pitched it. Geek Avenger is sold. So there you go. See what just happened, right, guys? You see what happened on our stream here? And I just got creator and consumer together. That is how we build. I love it. How we build. Totally. Let's see. I'm just going to scroll down a little more. You don't like black and white art, says Matt Bar? Did Geek Avenger back the first World Warrior Drake book? I don't know. Did you back the first World Warrior Drake book, Geek Avenger? You don't have to tell me if you did or didn't, but I love black and white art myself. I think black and white art is just so deep and so, atmospheric. Manicore says, stop highlighting your inadequacy, live peanut head. I'm just reading chats. I'm a man of the people. This is a chat republic. Oh, a wild Kirby appears. Yes, he is. He's right there. Hail Kirby. We have a meeting tomorrow. I mean, Mr. Kirby, a virtual meeting. But we have a meeting nonetheless tomorrow. He is going to help me train for my battle against Narwhal on the cockfight. So I'm going to be his Daniel LaRusso. I'm going to be Daniel LaRusso to his Mr. Miyagi, which makes sense because he's... yes. positive vibes from the stream. So what you're saying, JD Kirby, if I'm correct, what you're saying is that my idea is working. And an alternative to the degeneracy and the darkness that's hovering in our corner of the comic sphere is actually working, in that we are doing a good thing by being having fun and yet being creative and inspiring. That is what I'm getting from this work here. I will take this. I will take this as high praise. Dark Gear says, it is pronounced Hua. 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 I like my pronunciation better. Hua. 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 23 live viewers on Twitter, on YouTube, and 40 on Twitter. Hail. For a total of 63 live viewers. As for Bob says, hail. Hail, Bob. Bob. And of course, as we call them slappers here. Let's see here. Let's kick butt, says Kirby. Yes, I'm prepared for tomorrow. I'm absolutely going to kick butts. Matt Barr says, Rock and Roll Ninja is going to be black and white, but then some other stuff that's color, exosuits and shit. Lots of exosuits. Imagine if Exo Squad. I have to watch Exo Squad one day, the whole series. I've only watched like one episode, but I gotta watch the whole series one day. I remember some friends in high school swore by that show. Once me and Wiggle decide to crash the stream, it works. Well, it's still content for me, so no argument for me. Not at all. Whoa, says Mr. Ruckus. Darkus says, trying to teach a pop how to speak New York, New Jersey Italian is a list called lost. Lost! You king of typos. It's lost. Lost. Mr. Educate Jonal. Jonal. I'm trying to correct Darkif Java. Stop correcting me. I'm correcting him. Darkif messed up again. Again. With his terrible typos. A list calls, Darkif? Really? Really? You're trying to teach me how to talk, but you can't type? Are you sure you're a full-blooded Italian? I sense a little Sicilian in you. I think you're part Sicilian. Because Italians don't do typos. They do correct English. I think the Sicilian in you is causing you to make those typos. Let's see, scroll down more. So see, you gained parallel content, Dark Kid. It's not my fault. You did that. You did that. That's on you. So, Kirby, says Matt Barr. Kirby. Matt Barr responds to Mr. Ruckus. Ducks are grapers. Well, you know what? Oh, man, I had an old video. I took the video off, but I'll upload it one day. But, yeah, in one of my older intros was the Juice song with footage of the ducks doing awful things to their female counterparts. It was one of my more funnier intros, but... I moved on from it, but I guess I can put more into it. Again, says Jackson. Yeah, always with the typos. Always. Absolutely. People have been whacked for less, Peanut Head. Yeah, darkness has been allowed to just do his thing, wreck the English language. And it's funny because in this stream, as I was talking about Howard Finster and the way he marries words with art, let me bring up the picture here on the browser so that I can, you know, go back and forth with the browsers here. Excuse me. But the way he marries words with pictures, as I showed here. Oh wait, I gotta take off the here we go. How he marries words with pictures, and Dark Gift is messing with the English language. He's making a mockery out of Howard Finster's legacy. Total mockery. Absolute mockery. My typos are art. Well, you know what? Howard Finster's misspellings are art. If you look here, hold on the right here, when he says the English can see the power of God's earth, people should also. He spells also the way Dark Gift spells it. He spells it A-L-L-S-O as opposed to A-L-S-O. And this isn't the only time where he misspells words. As a matter of fact, to show you the other picture, the dinosaur picture. Here we go. He misspelled, what's the other word he misspelled? Over here, right? So you see where it says this box, right? Let me just bring it in more. Okay. So you see right here, guarantee, how he misspells guarantee. It's the one, it's the fourth line in the box. Guarantee earth time can be taken. He misspells guarantee. Howard Finster does. The same way Dark Gift misspells educational. Or the same way Dark Gift misspells lost. Oh, wait. Did I miss your comment? Hold on. What comment did I miss? Let me scroll back up. Let's see. What? No, this one? I highlighted that comment. I showed it. What are you talking about? And I cursed you for that. Because you're harassing. I didn't miss your comment. So, I don't know what you're talking about. I really don't. Metacore says I'm not touching that. Oh, he's talking about this comment by Matt Barr? Oh, no. No. We're not promoting violence on the stream. Absolutely not. We're not promoting violence on the stream, Carol. God, my throat is dry. All right, I think I'm going to call it a stream. I think 2 hours is good. I don't want to go for 3 or 4 hours. So 2 hours is good. And I do want to thank everybody for joining. And again, I like how it just goes back to the subject of the stream, which is Howard Finster. Because Dark Gift with his typos reminded me of Howard Finster and his misspellings. And it goes back. I love it. You cannot design or script a better outline for a stream than this. This was a perfect way to end the stream. This is a perfect way to do it. Thank you, Dark Gift. You have shown the organic nature of why these streams that I do are perfect and art unto itself. Your titles are art, just like Howard Finster's misspellings are art. You are both one and the same. Dark Gift, you are our generation's Howard Finster. So get to it. Become a Howard Finster, because we need more Howard Finsters in our community. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for tuning in. Have a great night. And of course, I leave you with my regular outro because I like my outros. Where's my outro? Oh, this outro.